كانوا بآياتنا يوقنون صلوات Part of the tradition of the Shia Muslims in general, we have gathered to commemorate two events together. One is the wafat of the father of the Imams, Hazrat Abu Talib alayhi salatu wa salam. And his sixth descendant, our seventh Imam, Imam Musa al Kazim, alayhi salatu wa salam. When we look at the role played by Abu Talib in supporting the Prophet of Islam and in furthering the cause of Islam during the Meccan era of the Prophet's life, we see that as far as the historians are concerned, they are very clear that he was a very important figure in this movement of Islam as long as he was alive. It is to his credit that as long as he was alive, the Quraysh never dared to physically harm the Prophet of Islam. They also talk about his contribution not only by supporting the Prophet in a physical sense, but also through his prestige, especially even during the time when Ali Muhammad, the Banu Hashim, where they had to go through these 3 years of what is known as socio-political boycott by the Quraysh. But what is amazing is that if you look at the historians, although they talk about Abu Talib, his contribution as far as Islam is concerned, but they always emphasize this point, that he died as a kafir. And that is where the Shias, you know, emphasize this point, that we have to really defend the status of Abu Talib. Because even now we see, for example, one of the fundamental problems that we have in the Muslim world is this mentality known as takfiri. The word takfiri, this is where kufr comes in. And takfiri mentality means this attitude where you label others as kafir, right and left. And this is a term which has been coined recently in the last, you know, 10 years or so to describe the extremist Salafis and Wahhabis. Because it is they who go around looking at other Muslims. We are not even talking about non-Muslims. They just look at other Muslims and those who do not agree with their theology of Wahhabism or Salafism, they use that label of kufr on them and they say they are kafir. And it's not that difficult. Once you have labeled an individual or a group as a kafir, it's not difficult, you know, to get ignorant people in Afghanistan or the border areas of Pakistan and Afghanistan, where these ignorant people are brainwashed that if you kill one kafir, you know, you get a, you know, speedy passage to Jannat with the huris waiting for you. And so it's not only the issue of putting this label. Actually, that label leads to this issue of violence that we see in Afghanistan, in Pakistan, as well as Iraq. Just 2 days ago, since the wafat of Imam Musa al Kazim alayhi salam is commemorated, in a big way in Kazimain, which is the shrine of the Imam, where the Iraqis, very similar, of course, in a very smaller scale, go to the shrine of the Imam. Some of them even walk from their villages. And this is what, you know, hurts the Salafis. And even now, in spite of all the security measures taken by the Iraqi government, just on Thursday, the report that I saw, there were different areas where explosions took place, and about 25 pilgrims and Zawar of the Imam were killed. And so when we look at this, we come to realize that, you know, what is happening now can be connected to what was happening in the early days as far as history, historians are concerned when it came to the image of Abu Talib. This attitude of takfir, using this label of kafir on others, this is actually a product, and its roots can be found in the Umayyid era. This is the Banu Umayyah mentality and the first mazlum-e-tariq, as we call him. The oppressed person in Muslim history is Hazrat Abu Talib, on whom they started using this label of kafir in spite of all his words and action in support of the Deen of Islam and the Risalat of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There is an interview a few years ago when this is after the post-Saddam era, basically early years, when the Iraqis were going for the ziyarat of Imam Musa al Kazim. There was, you know, confusion was created, which led to stampede across the bridge which takes people to Kazimain. And many people actually were killed in that. Because there was a, you know, somebody just said that, oh, there is a bomb exploded somewhere ahead of us. And people started to run in different directions. It's interesting, I can never forget that scene of a BBC reporter who was talking to an Iraqi old lady who was being pushed by her daughter or a close relative, a lady, you know, pushed in the wheelchair, going towards the ziyarat. And soon after the explosion, the reporter asked her, are you still going to go? And her remark really represents the Shia spirit. She said, physically I am disabled, but my loyalty to the Imam is not disabled. It is still complete. So you can use bombs, you can use whatever you want, but you cannot diminish the spirit of the loyalty and love that we have towards Imam Musa al-Kazim, the Imams of Ahlul Bayt, and Hazrat Abu Talib. Salawat. Let me narrate to you a very interesting conversation. Remember that the history of Islam, even the biography of the Prophet, was put into written form much later on, towards the later Umayyad period and early Abbasid era. Yes, the narrations were there, but they were just being circulated verbally. It was the oral tradition of history which continued during the early days. Because there was a problem. The policy of the Khulafa from day one, after Wafat of Rasul, was the prohibition of writing down the ahadith. Even the hadith of Rasulullah, they would not allow Muslims to put them in writing. And the reason we know. But the excuse was that, oh, we do not want the importance of the Quran to be diminished. Therefore, it is forbidden to write a hadith. This stopped that, but the oral tradition continued. Later on, it was put in a written form. So, for example, one of the earliest biography of the Prophet, known as Sirah ibn Hisham, which is actually a summary of Ibn Ishaq's Sirah, and the original is lost. What we have is a summary which was actually summarized during the early days of Banu Abbas. And so this is even before it, this conversation. There was a governor in Mecca. The governor of Walid bin Abdul Malik, one of the Umayyad Khulafa, and his governor in Mecca was Khalid bin Abdullah al-Qasri. He actually one day called a scholar who was known to be a good scholar of history. And he asked him that, I would like you to compile a seerah, a biography of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. when the governor of Mecca made this request to the scholar, he asked the governor a question, which is very interesting. And it shows that this fellow knew history very well. He says, فَإِنَّهُ يَمُرُّ بِي أَشَّيْ مِنْ سِيرَةِ عَلِي بِنْ أَبِي طَالِبِ فَأَذْكُرُهُ. He says, O governor, tell me, when I'm compiling the seerah of Rasulullah, many events related to Ali also comes there when I write the biography of Rasulullah. Do I mention that or not? Because he knew their mentality. And we wanted to not get in trouble. And the response that he gave, you know, before I go to that, you see, the problem is, you know, one of the contemporary poets of India, Dr. Payam Azmi, is a very good manqabat, piece of poetry, where he talks about a conversation between himself. Of course, this is a poetic way of putting it, where somebody, you know, comes to him and says that, you know, you people, whenever you talk about history, you only mention Ali. Can you at least just talk about Rasulullah without Ali? And he said, okay, if you want me to talk about the biography of Rasulullah, and then he has this very beautiful poetry where he goes on, he says, tell me, where should I begin? Should I talk about the first da'wah that Rasulullah did to invite his family members? And he said, no, no, because if you start that, you will end up with the introduction of Ali by Rasulullah, that he is my brother and wazir and khalifa. He says, okay, should I start with the hijrat? He says, no, 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 don't talk about it, otherwise we'll talk about the sacrifice of Ali, you know, sleeping in the place of Rasulullah. He says, then what do I do? Do I talk about Badr and Uhud? He says, even there, Ali played a prominent role. Talk about something where only Rasul is there. He says, then what do I do? Do I talk about Khandaq and Khaybar? He says, no. Again, Ali is there, you know. Say, what do I do? Do I talk about the last Hajj of Rasulullah? He says, no, you will end up talking about Ghadir when he's coming back from there. You know, so whatever you talk about the biography of Rasulullah, Ali is there. You cannot separate Ali from the seerah of Ali from the seerah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. You know, as he ends up in the line where he says, Ahmed ki baat, baat mein Haydar ki baat hai. What can I do? You know, whatever I talk about Ahmed, you know, Ali is there. And so that was in the mind of this historian who is now asking the governor. He says, when I'm writing this seerah for Rasulullah, what do I do with the events where Ali is there? And look at the answer. I didn't like to translate this response from the governor, but I think for us to understand and realize what was happening those days, the mazlumiyat of Abu Talib and Ali, he says, La. He says, when you are writing this seerah of Rasulullah, if anything comes about Ali, don't write it. Illa an tarahu fi qa'ri jahannam, na'uzu billah. He says, the only thing you can write about him is if you place him in the lowest level of jahannam. You know, that was the attitude of the rulers as far as Banu Umayyah are concerned. And with that hatred against Ali bin Abi Talib, you know, that is extended to Abu Talib as the father of Ali. Because Umayyids, in their own, you know, perspective of history, they see, okay, there is Ali and his family, and then there is Muawiyah and his family. And they see, okay, Abu Sufyan is the father of Muawiyah. Doesn't really have any good role as far as the history of Rasulullah and Islam is concerned. On the other hand, they look at Ali, they don't like him. And his father has played a very major role in survival of Islam during the early days. And they didn't, because they didn't like Ali, they wanted to bring the status of Abu Talib down. And the very first thing they started was this mentality of takfir, using the label of kafir on Hazrat Abu Talib. And that is the mentality we see even continuing now, and the Muslim world is suffering because of the violence based on that mentality of takfir. Salawat on Iqbal. As far as his words are concerned, you know, basically they are saying, oh, we didn't see him ever reciting the Shahadat. If you really, if we sit down, classifying people as Muslim and non-Muslim, based on if I have heard somebody reciting the Shahadatain or not, then the majority of my own audience in that list would be non-Muslim, because I didn't hear. Who told you that you have to listen to the Shahadatain of somebody? You know, you have to look at their action, their words. Those days, poetry was very powerful. And Abu Talib is known as one of the famous poets of the time. There is actually an entire Diwan. Diwan means the collection of the poetry of the poet. Diwan Abu Talib. And there, if you see some of the words he uses in describing the Prophet, and just some selections from it, this is a time when the Quraysh realized that Abu Talib is not going to relinquish his support for Rasulullah. And he was in a very prestigious chief of Mecca. And because of that, they were afraid. They couldn't do anything to Rasulullah. So then they came to him one day as a bargain. And you know, they're so low class people, I would say. They come to him and they say, oh, Abu Talib, you know, we have the most handsome young man in Mecca with very good character, you know, rich person. We will bring it to him to you. You take him as your son and give Muhammad to us so that we may kill him. And Abu Talib said, you know, what kind of a bargain you are proposing to me? You want me to give my nephew to you so that you may kill him? And I raise your, a stranger in my house? You know, he refused. And this is where he then expressed his sentiments in two lines where he says, مَنَعْنَا الرَّسُولُ رَسُولُ الْمَلِيكِ بِبَيْذٍ تَلَعْلَعَ كَلَمْعِ الْبُرُوقِ. He says, we defended the messenger of the king. Here, Malik refers to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We defended him with the bright swords which radiated like lightning. أَضُودُ وَأَحْمِي رَسُولِ الْمَلِيكِ حِمَايَةَ حَمٍ عَلَيْهِ شَفِيقٍ. I will defend him and protect the messenger of the king, protection of a guardian who is, you know, affectionate towards him. This is the sentiment of somebody who believes in him as Rasulul Malik, as the messenger of Allah who is Malikul Mulk. You know, what more do you want? Not only that, if you look at the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, says that when it comes to Rasul, we had instructed Musa and Isa, because they came before Rasulullah, that they have to talk about the last prophet to their communities. And look at his understanding. أَلَمْ تَعْلَمُوا أَنَّا وَجَدْنَا مُحَمَّدًا نَبِيًّا كَمُوسَى خُطَّ فِي أَوَّلِ الْكُتُبِ. He says, do not you know that we have found Muhammad as a Nabi mentioned in the earlier scriptures? So Abu Talib is informed, knowledgeable, and aware that Muhammad is a Nabi who has been foretold in the scriptures and the books which had come before. Salawat Pradhan Iqbal. Of course, we believe that he did not necessarily always display his iman on the principle of taqiyya, because he wanted to use his prestige and his status in the society of Mecca as a way of protecting Rasulullah and his young religion. But if you look at, you know, those who were around him, look at his attitude towards those who were close to him and their support for Rasulullah. When Hamza is the brother of Abu Talib, younger one. Actually, age-wise, Hamza and Rasulullah were of the same age, although they were uncle and nephew. And so Hamza is much younger than Abu Talib. And the day Hamza declared his iman on the deen of Islam, and he actually challenged the Quraysh that if you ever do anything to my nephew, you will first have to deal with me. And he was known as a very courageous person. And when Abu Talib found out that Hamza has become a Muslim, look at the way he talks to him. Again, using poetry, he says, "Sabran Aba Ya'la ala deeni Ahmad." Be patient and steadfast, O Abu Ya'la. This is the kunya of Hamza. On the deen and the religion of Ahmad. وَكُنْ مُضْحِرًا لِلدِّينِ وَفَّقْتَ صَابِرًا. And be patient in supporting the deen, and may you be successful. فَقَدْ سَرَّنِي إِذْ قُلْتَ إِنَّكَ مُؤْمِنٌ. I was very well, very, very much delighted when you said that you have become a mu'min. فَكُنْ لِرَسُولِ اللَّهِ فِي اللَّهِ نَاصِرًا. Therefore, be a nasir and a helper of Rasulullah for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What better iman do you want? Look at his sentiments. The way he's encouraging Hamza become a nasir for Rasulullah for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's not only saying support him, but support him with sincerity in order to help the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even during the last stages of his life, this is just before he dies, again he had gathered his family members and he had made a wasiyyat to Bani Hashim in general to support the cause of Rasulullah. But these are very specific lines that he uttered at that time where he says, "Awsi bi nasr al-nabi al-khayr mashhaduhu." Aliyan ibni wa shaykh al-qawmi Abbas. He says, I enjoin, I do the wasiyyat to help the Nabi. Which Nabi? Al-khayru mashhaduhu, whose presence is good itself. When he is there, that is the source of goodness. He says, I enjoin to help this Nabi. Whom do I enjoin to? Aliyan ibni, Ali my son. And the head of our family, Abbas, because Abbas was now going to be the head of the Banu Hashim. Wa Hamza al-Asad al-Hami haqiqatuhu. And Hamza the lion, who defends best on his reality. Wa Ja'far an yaduduhu dun al-nas. And even Ja'far, I advise him to prevent the evil people from Rasulullah. كونوا فدا لكم أمي وما ولدت في نصر أحمد دون الناس أتراسا. He says, may my mother and the children born from her be fidya and sacrifice for Ahmad and his deen. Be among the supporters of Ahmad and prevent the evil from him. Salawat alaykum barakatuh. And his only fault is that he was the father of Ali. Otherwise, his actions and his words are more than enough to prove that he was a mu'min and a Muslim in the true sense. When I was just reading recently a narration very interesting from one of the Sunni sources. Of course, they will come and say this is za'if and this and that, but I'm not concerned about it. At least it is there in their book. It's not from our source. Where at the time of the conquest of Mecca, when the people of Mecca started, you know, doing bay'at to Rasulullah, of course, they didn't really have much choice. And they used to come to him and pledge allegiance. One of the individuals who was brought to the presence of Rasulullah was the father of Abu Bakr. Qahafa. He was very old. and blind. And Abu Bakr brought him to the presence of Rasulullah so that he may do bay'at at the hand of Rasul and become a Muslim in Fath-e Makka. When Rasulullah looked at his old age, and he's a blind person, Rasulullah, out of his, you know, he was rahmatun lil alameen. According to that narration, he says to Abu Bakr, there was no need to bring him all the way here for bay'at. Maybe I would have gone one day to his house and, you know, you could have done bay'at. But Abu Bakr says, no, Rasulullah, I wanted him to get the blessings from you by doing bay'at and becoming a Muslim, because I can still remember the delight on your eyes when you saw the Islam and Iman of your uncle Abu Talib. This is a testimony from Abu Bakr. It's not from our books. It is in your books. What else do you want? And so it shows that it was more the Umayyid era where this fabrication was started. That because they wanted to diminish the status of Ali bin Abi Talib, tarnish his image, they also targeted Abu Talib. You know, and started using this attitude of takfir and the label of kafir for one of the earliest mu'min in the history of Islam, Hazrat Abu Talib, alayhi salatu wassalam. Salawat. On the 13th of Rajab, when I was talking about some of the statements of Ali in Nahj al-Balagha, where he was talking about Ahlul Bayt and himself, one of the statements he has for Ahlul Bayt, he says, "Bihim istaqama dhahruhu." That is, through the Ahlul Bayt that the backbone of Islam was straight. Means if the religion of Islam is like a human body, the backbone of that religion is Ahlul Bayt. They are the one who kept it straight. Keep that, you know, wordings in mind and look at the tribute that we have from Ibn Abi al-Hadid al-Mu'tazili for Abu Talib and Ali. Ibn Abi al-Hadid al-Mu'tazili is a Sunni scholar who has written a very extensive commentary of Nahj al-Balagha. And in that commentary, there is a section where he talks about the biography of Abu Talib. And he has two very beautiful lines there where he says, "Lawla Abu Talib wa ibnuhu, lama mathala ad-deenu shaqsan faqama." He says, if it hadn't been for Abu Talib and his son, the religion of Islam would not have been shaped rightly. Qama, it would not have stood up properly. But for Abu Talib and his son. فَزَاكَ بِمَكَّةَ آوَى وَحَامَى وَحَاذَى بِيَثْرِبْ جَسَّلِ هِمَامَى. This one, the father, sacrificed and protected and defended Islam in Mecca. And this one, referring to the son, you know, rubbed his shoulders with death in the Madani era. As the father and son both sacrificed in order to support Islam, one in Mecca and one in Medina. Salawat. And that is why the Shia, you know, historians call him Mazlumi Tariq. Because somebody who played such an important role in survival of Islam during the difficult early years of Islam, he is being, you know, branded as a kafir. And we see the mentality of this takfiri group even now. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give, you know, guidance and wisdom to them. And if they are not capable of receiving guidance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, may Allah eliminate their power so that they do not hurt the true mu'mineen and the Shia of Ali around the world. Salawat. Just one more statement about Abu Talib, just to understand the greatness of this man. He had four sons, all from Fatima bint Asad. You know, the importance of Abu Talib and his wife, Fatima bint Asad, can be seen even in the events of Karbala. Normally, we divide the Shuhada of Karbala between Banu Hashim, the Shuhada of Banu Hashim, and the Shuhada who are known as Ansar of Imam Hussein, who are not from the family members. But among those who are the family members, although the term Banu Hashim is being used, all of them, without any exception, all 18 individuals from the family who were killed in Karbala, and if we add Muslim bin Aqil to that list, all of them are actually descendants of Abu Talib and Fatima bint Asad. They are not from other lines of Banu Hashim. They are not from Abbasid, for example. And so even Karbala actually is the manifestation of the sacrifice which was started by Abu Talib and Fatima bint Asad. All of them are there representing his spirit and loyalty and sacrifice that he demonstrated during the early days of the history. You know, many times when we talk about Imam Hussein alayhi salam, we say he was the grandson of the Prophet, which is absolutely true, and Rasulullah is at the top. But we forget the other side. He's not only grandson of Rasulullah, he's also the grandson of Abu Talib. And that spirit has continued in this family. When we look at our seventh Imam, the sixth of the descendants of Abu Talib through Ali and Hussein going further, you know, the role that our Imams played in different times. We can look at it in different ways, but, you know, looking at the time factor, I was just selected one or two events as a moral and lesson for us. One is his title, Al-Kadhim. Al-Kadhim is one of the virtues in Islamic akhlaq, which comes from kadhmul ghayz, to suppress and control the anger. And this is one of the ongoing challenges of human beings all the time. Each one of us, at one time or another, some at a lesser degree, some at, you know, more frequent, at higher degree, they suffer from this problem of controlling the anger. And if you look at Imam Musa al Kazim alayhi salam, of course, all the Imams, we can call them Kazim. Especially Imam, the seventh Imam, was known Kazim because of his attitude towards those who were known to be his enemies. There was a fellow from the descendants of the second Khalifa, Umar ibn Khattab, who used to badmouth the Imam all the time, whenever he would see him. And not only the Imam, he would even talk very negative things about Amir al-Mu'mineen. To the extent that some of the companions of the seventh Imam, when they heard this again and again, some of them became so angry, they actually asked the Imam, do you allow us to do something just to eliminate this fellow? Because he really is going beyond the appropriate limit when he's talking about you and Amir al-Mu'mineen. And Imam Musa al-Kazim said, no, I don't allow you to do that. And he dealt with this situation in his own way. He first inquired about him, that where is his house? And he goes to his house, and the family members told him he's not home, he's working in one of his farms. So Imam got on his horse, you know, took the address from them, went to the farm. And when Imam started coming towards him, he became kind of, you know, annoyed because of his attitude of, you know, hatred towards Ali and Ali. And he said, you know, why are you trampling my farm, you know, destroying my crops here? Imam came close, sat down, you know, started to talk to him politely, asked about his well-being and health. And then Imam said, you know, how much do you expect from this produce that you have, the crops? What are your expectations? And even the part that you think I have destroyed the crops, you know, what is the value of that? He said, well, this, the value is 100 dinar. And he says, how much do you expect from everything here, the produce? He says he was irritated. He says, "Ana la a'lamul ghayb. I don't know. I don't have the knowledge of, you know, ghayb. I don't know how much." Imam said, "I didn't tell you that you know. I asked you, what is your expectation? How much do you expect to get from this?" He says, 200 dinars. Imam took out 300 dinars from his pocket and gave it to him. And he said, "This is my hadiah to you. And I don't want anything from your crops and your produce. This is yours. So this is yours, and this money is also yours." And then Imam left. This kindness with an enemy actually forced him to think about the akhlaq of Ahlul Bayt. You know, there is one way of going and dealing with the enemy is to kill him, and the other is to convert him. And Imam said, "There is no need to kill him. Let us see, you know, use our akhlaq, our patience and sabr, kadhmul ghayz, and see maybe if it will work or not." And so then that same day or next day in Masjid al-Nabi, when the Imam came and he was there and the Ashab were there, they were surprised to see the change in his attitude, the way he was talking to the Imam, praising his akhlaq. And this is where Imam, you know, turned to them and to his companions. And he says, "Ayyuma kana khayr." Which of the two options was better? Your option that you were asking me, or the method that I used to convert him? And they said, "Of course, your method was better." And so we see that, yes, sometimes when we hear things from others, not necessarily on a personal level, even on the in the matters of religion, you know, sometimes, many times probably, exercising patience, controlling our anger would really help us in order to even convert an enemy into a friend. Salawat upon the Ikbar. Especially when it comes to family members. You know, can you ask the brothers to move a little bit more further here? Anger basically is shaitanat. The way our hadith describe that, so you don't see it, but it's a fire inside. They say if you take two rocks and rub them together, you see the spark. So there's fire in there. When friction happens, it comes out. And you see the fear, the fire on your face, on your ears. You touch it, it's warm. And that's where you come to realize, okay, it's not like the way we have the fire in the fireplace, but it is there inside. And that has to be controlled. Especially when we are talking about the family members, you know, our imams have gone actually out of the way even to describe what to do. If you are standing and you are angry, Imam, you know, the hadith says, sit down. You might calm down. And if you're sitting down and angry, lie down. If not, go and drink a glass of water. And if it doesn't work, you know, go and take a shower. I'm just extending that, actually. It's not hadith. Yeah. You know, it might cool you down. Especially if they are people who are related to you by blood. We are told that if you just, you know, in a way touch them, that relationship of blood will calm the person down. And so this is when we talk about Imam Musa al Kazim alayhi salam, you see this. The way he behaved with the people even in Medina, there were many people who didn't know him. Only when he was arrested by Harun and taken away at a very short notice. They actually arrested him inside Masjid al-Nabi. They did not even allow him to go home. And this is Harun was there at the time. And he was then taken to Iraq. That's where many poor people realized that the person who used to come in the darkness of the night and, you know, give bread to us, is no more in the city. And so when we talk about the charity of the Imam, the goodness of the Imam, Kazmul Ghayz, these are the issues that we have to keep in mind, that it's not only for the praise of the Imam, these are lessons that we have to learn and try to implement that in our own daily lives. Salawat ala Akbar. Imam Musa al Kazim alayhi salam aur janab Abu Talib ki is wafat ki munasibat se ek waqia janab Abu Talib ke bare mein aur ek waqia Imam Musa al Kazim alayhi salam ke bare mein pesh karke majlis ko khatam karna chahenge. With apologies for those who do not understand Urdu at all, but you can ask from your friends later on. Two narrations that I have here. Ek to janab Abu Talib ke iman ke bare mein, ye already Banu Umayyah ki jo propaganda department tha Muawiyah ka, uske asar already Ali ke zamane mein numaya ho chuke the. Imam Hassan ki ek riwayat milti hai ki Kufa mein public gathering thi, ghaliban masjid mein, jahan ek shakhs aake Amir al-Mu'minin se sawal karta hai ki ya Amir al-Mu'minin innaka bil makan alladhi anzalaka Allah wa abuka mu'adhdhabun fin nar. Yani ye takleef dene ki jo baat hoti hai na, ise kehte hain is type ka questions. Kahe Amir al-Mu'minin, aapka martaba aur status to wo hai jo Allah ne aapko diya hai, lekin aapke baba jo hain wo jahannam ki aag mein unko azab lag raha hai, usme mubtala hai wo. Amir al-Mu'minin us waqt bahar ha gussa to aata hai, fauran kehte hain mahfadallahu fak, that may Allah break your mouth for uttering these words. والذي بعث محمدا بالحق نبيا, us khuda ki qasam jisne Muhammad ko nabi bana ke bheja hai, لو شفع عبي في كل مذنب على وجه الارض شفعه الله. میرے بابا کا وہ مرتبہ ہے کہ قیامت کے دن اگر میرے بابا جتنے گناہگار ہیں زمین پر ان کی اگر شفاعت کرے قیامت کے دن تو خداوند عالم اس کی شفاعت کو قبول کرے گا. یعنی وہ سٹیٹس ہے اللہ کی نظر میں ابو طالب کا. پھر فرماتے ہیں ابی معذب فی النار و ابنه قسیم الجنت والنار. تمہاری عقل کہاں گئی کہ میرے بابا جو ہے جہنم کے عذاب میں مبتلا ہوں اور بیٹا جو ہے لوگوں کو جہنم اور جنت میں تقسیم کرنے والا ہو؟ doesn't make sense. تو یہ مظلومیت جو ہے جناب ابو طالب کی, یہ کوئی نئی بات نہیں ہے, شروع سے چل رہا ہے سلسلہ. اور خود امیر المومن کے زمانے میں بھی اس ٹائپ کی باتیں خود امیر المومن کے سامنے ہی ہوتی تھی, جس سے امام کو اذیت بھی پہنچتی تھی. اور اسی لیے ہم لوگ ذکر کرتے ہیں, معصومین میں ان کا شمار نہیں ہوتا ہے, انبیاء میں ان کا شمار نہیں ہوتا ہے, لیکن یہ محسن اسلام ہے, اسلام پر احسان ہے ان کا. انہوں نے رسول کی حمایت کی ہے, اور جس زمانے میں جس سال وفات ہوئی ابو طالب اور خدیجہ کی, یہ دو سپورٹیو پلرز تھے رسول کی زندگی میں. ان کے وفات کے بعد جبرائیل نے آ کے کہا, محمد اب مکہ جو ہے محفوظ جگہ نہیں ہے آپ کے لیے. عجیب و غریب ہے, جبرائیل نازل ہوتے ہیں ابو طالب کے وفات کے بعد, محمد اب مکہ آپ کے لیے رہنے کی جگہ نہیں ہے, اس لیے کہ جو محافظ تھا وہ اب زندہ نہیں ہے. تو اسی سے اندازہ ہوتا ہے کہ جناب ابو طالب بھی مظلوم واقع ہوئے ہیں, صرف اس لیے کہ یہ علی کے بابا تھے. جس طرح سے علی کے شیعوں کو بھی یہ کافر کہہ رہے ہیں, اسی طرح سے علی کے بابا کو بھی یہ کافر اس زمانے میں کہتے تھے, ابھی بھی کہتے ہیں. خداوند عالم ان کی ہدایت فرمائے, اور اگر قابل ہدایت نہیں ہے تو ان کے شر کو مومنین سے دور رکھے. صلوات پڑھیں. امام مسعود کاظم علیہ السلام کی زندگی سے صرف ایک واقعہ سیرت کے حوالے سے, تاکہ کچھ سبق بھی ہمیں مل سکے. کمیونٹی میں ایک دوسرے سے ہمدردی کا اظہار, کنسرن ہونا, ایک دوسرے کی مدد کرنا. ٹھیک ہے یہاں لائف اسٹائل ذرا لوگوں کی ڈفرینٹ ہے, لیکن پھر بھی کوشش کرنا چاہیے کہ انسان ان مواقع اور اپورچونیٹیز کی تلاش میں رہے کہ جہاں ایک مومن بھائی کی مدد کر سکے. ایک شخص آیا تھا امام موسیٰ کاظم علیہ السلام کے پاس, اور یہ شہر رے کا رہنے والا تھا. شہر رے یہ تہران کے ساؤتھ میں ایک ٹاؤن ہے جہاں شاہ عبدالعظیم کا روضہ ہے, اور یہ شہر پہلے تھا مشہور, اور تہران صرف یہ پہاڑی علاقے میں ایک ولیج تھا, بعد میں یہ اور بڑا ہو گیا رے سے بھی. عمر ابن سعد نے وہیں کی گورنرشپ کے لیے خواہش میں اپنے کو جہنم میں ڈال دیا. تو وہاں کا یہ ایک شیعہ رہنے والا تھا جس پر گورنمنٹ اتھارٹیز نے جو ٹیکس لگایا تھا بہت زیادہ تھا. خطرہ تھا کہ اس کے جتنی ملکیت ہے اس کو وہ ضبط کر لیں گے. تو اس نے جب گورنر کے بارے میں پوچھا کہ یہ کون ہے, تو اس کو بتایا گیا کہ اس کا نام علی بن طاہر السوری ہے اور یہ شیعہ ہے. تو خود یہ شیعہ تھا. تو یہ جاتا ہے مدینہ, امام موسیٰ کاظم علیہ السلام سے ملاقات کی, اور پھر اپنا پرابلم پیش کیا کہ جتنا ٹیکس ہم پر آ گیا ہے وہ ہمارے بس کی بات نہیں ہے, ہم بالکل ہی مفلس ہو جائیں گے, اور وہاں کا گورنر جو ہے شہر رائے کا وہ شیعہ ہے, تو آپ ذرا سفارش لکھ دیں اس کے لیے. تو امام نے خط لکھ کے دیا اس کو, بہت ہی مختصر تین جملے ہیں. اعلم, اس شخص کے نام, ان اللہ ان للہ تحت عرشہ ظلالا لا یسکنہ الا من اسد الی اخیہ معروفا او نفس عنہ کربہ او ادخل فی قلبہ سرورا. امام لکھتے ہیں اس شخص کے لیے جو گورنر ہے کہ تمہیں جاننا چاہیے کہ قیامت کے دن خداوند عالم نے ایک کینپی بنائی ہے اپنے عرش کے پاس, ایک سایہ ہے جس کے نیچے کوئی نہیں آ سکتا ہے مگر وہ شخص جو اپنے کسی مومن بھائی کی مدد کرے, یا اس کی تکلیف کو رفع کرے, یا اس کے دل کو خوش کر دے. صرف پیسے کی بات نہیں ہو رہی ہے, یا تو صدقہ خیرات سے اس کی مدد کرے, یا اس کی تکلیف کو برطرف کرے, یا اسے خوش کر دے. وہذا اخوک, ارے گورنر, یہ شخص جو لیٹر لے کے آ رہا ہے یہ تمہارا دینی بھائی ہے, شیعہ ہے. والسلام, دیٹس اٹ. تو وہ وہاں مدینہ سے پھر مکہ گیا, حج کا زمانہ تھا. حج کرنے کے بعد شہر رے واپس آیا, اور رات کے وقت وہ گورنر کے گھر جاتا ہے. وہ جو ڈور مین تھا اس نے پوچھا تم کون ہو, کس لیے آئے ہو, تو اس نے کہا کہ گورنر سے کہہ دو کہ ہم موسیٰ کاظم کے قاصد ہیں, میسنجر ہیں. تو جیسے اس نے گورنر کو نام بتایا کہ موسیٰ کاظم کا میسنجر آیا ہے, تو وہ دوڑتا ہوا بیئر فوٹڈ فوراً دروازے تک آیا, اس شخص کا بوسہ لیا اور اس کو احترام کے ساتھ اندر لے آیا. خط جب اسے ملا تو اس کو بھی وہ چومتا ہے. اس کے بعد کھولنے کے بعد اس نے پڑھا کہ امام نے جو سفارش لکھی ہے اس کے لیے. تو وہ فوراً اپنے نوکروں کو حکم دیتا ہے کہ ہمارا جتنا سامان ہے سب لے آؤ, ڈیوائڈ کرتا ہے دو حصوں میں, اور اسے کہتا ہے ایک تم رکھ لو اپنے لیے, ایک ہمارا ہے بقیہ, اور جو چیزیں اس قابل نہیں ہیں کہ جس کو ہم لوگ ڈیوائڈ کر سکیں اس کی ویلیو تم لے لو مجھ سے. اور پھر اس نے پوچھا کہ اب یہ بتاؤ تمہاری ضرورت پوری ہو گئی؟ اس نے کہا کہ بھائی آپ نے تو ہماری نیڈ اور ضرورت سے زیادہ ہمیں دے دیا ہے. اور پھر اس نے اپنے ریونیو آفیسر کو بلایا کہ تمہارا وہ جو ٹیکس کا جو بک ہے سب لکھا ہے کس نو کس کو کتنا دینا ہے, وہ لے کے آؤ, اور اس کے نام کے سامنے جو بھی ہے تم اپنی اتھارٹی پر ہم اسے معاف کر رہے ہیں. تو اسے بھی اریسٹ کر دیا گیا. تو یہ شخص جو ہے بہرحال بہت خوش ہوا, اور پھر وہ پوچھتا بھی ہے گورنر کہ کیا تم اب راضی ہو مجھ سے؟ اس نے کہا یقیناً, تم نے تو جتنا ہمیں چاہیے تھا اس سے زیادہ کیا ہے. پھر کئی مہینوں کے بعد وہ شخص جو ہے دوبارہ جاتا ہے مدینہ, امام کی خدمت میں پہنچتا ہے اور اس پورے واقعے کو بیان کرتا ہے, اور پھر امام سے پوچھتا ہے کہ مولا کیا آپ اس گورنر سے راضی ہیں اس نے آپ کو خوش کیا ہے اس وقت امام کہتے ہیں اے واللہ فقد سرنی وسر امیر المؤمنین واللہ لقد سر جد رسول اللہ اس نے نہ صرف مجھے خوش کیا ہے اپنے ایک مومن بھائی کی مدد کر کے اس نے مجھے خوش کیا ہے امیر المومنین کو خوش کیا ہے رسول اللہ کو خوش کیا ہے وَلَقَدْ سَرَّ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى اس نے خدا کو بھی راضی اور خوشنود کیا ہے تو یہ در حقیقت اہمیت ہے جو امام بتا رہے ہیں کہ جب آپس میں کمیونٹی کی بات ہوتی ہے وہاں ولایت کا جذبہ یہی ہے کہ انسان ایک دوسرے کے کام آ سکے ایک دوسرے کے مشکل حالات میں صلوات پڑھ دیں ایک بار اور امام موسیٰ کاظم علیہ السلام کی گرفتاری کے سلسلے میں صرف ایک واقعہ بیان کر کے پھر ہم مصائب کی طرف آنا چاہیں گے کہ ہارون گیا ہوا تھا عمرہ اور حج کے لیے غالباً مدینہ جب پہنچا ہے چونکہ یہ لوگ بنو عباس کے تھے ابو طالب کے ایک بھائی تھے عباس رسول اللہ کے والد کا نام عبداللہ تھا علی کے والد کا نام ابو طالب تھا تو یہ اپنے کو بنو ہاشم کہتے تھے بہرحال بنو ہاشم تھے لیکن یہ بنو عباس کے نسل سے تھے تو اپنے اس کلوز ریلیشن شپ کو بتانے کے لیے ہارون جب روزے رسول کے پاس پہنچا ہے تو اس نے جو زیارت کی ہے السلام علیک ابن عم کزن ہوئے نا یہ عبداللہ کے نسل سے ہیں رسول اللہ اور یہ لوگ عبداللہ یہ عباس کے نسل سے ہیں تو ایک لحاظ سے کزن ہوئے تو اس نے سلام کیا اپنے حواریون کو بتانے کے لیے کہ آئی ایم سو کلوز ٹو رسول اللہ کہ ہمارا سلام ہے السلام علیک ابن عم سلام ٹو یو او مائی کزن تھوڑی دیر میں اسی وقت وہاں موجود تھا یہ ہارون امام آتے ہیں اور امام نے سلام کیا السلام علیک یا ابتا اس لیے کہ رسول اللہ جو ہیں امام کے وہ صرف کزن کی بات نہیں ہے یہ تو ان کے ڈسینڈنٹ ہیں فاطمہ کے ذریعے ہارون کے دل میں یہ جو ہے جلن کہ بھائی ہی کہ انہوں نے ہمیں پٹ ڈاؤن کرنا چاہا ہے ہم نے تو ابن عم کہا ہے وہ کہتے ہیں السلام علیک یا ابتا اور اسی جلن کی بنیاد پر وہ ملعون جو ہے حکم دیتا ہے امام کی گرفتاری کے لیے اور گھر جائے بغیر وہاں سے سیدھے ان کو بصرہ بھیج دیتا ہے ایک زندان بان کے پاس اس زمانے میں جیل کوئی الگ نہیں ہوتے تھے لیکن لوگوں کے حوالے کیا جاتا تھا کہ آپ ان کو قید کریں گے اپنے گھر میں اور ہارون نے اس سے کہا بھی کہ تم ان کو زہر دے دو لیکن امام کے اخلاق کو دیکھ کے زندان میں بھی وہ بصرہ میں جو زندان بان تھا اس نے کہا یہ ہم سے نہیں ہونے والا ہے پھر امام کو ٹرانسفر کیا گیا بغداد میں بغداد میں بھی دو غالباً جیلرز بدلے ہیں جنہوں نے انکار کیا ہارون سے کہ ہم ان کو زہر دینے کے لیے تیار نہیں ہیں اس لیے کہ ہم نے کوئی ان میں کوئی برائی نہیں دیکھی ہے یہ بندہ جو ہے صرف عبادت میں وقت گزار رہا ہے کسی کا برا نہیں چاہتا ہے یہ یعنی یہ لوگ خلیفہ کے حکم کی مخالفت کرتے ہیں آخر میں ہارون نے اس کو ایک ملعون سند بن شاہق کے حوالے کیا کہ جو تیار ہوا کہ امام کو کھانے میں زہر دیا جائے اور امام کو قید خانے ہی میں یہی رجب کے ایام تھے آخری ایام تھے کہ امام کو زہر دیا گیا اور پانچ دن کی طبیعت کی خرابی کے بعد امام کی روح جو ہے اس جسم سے جدا ہو جاتی ہے عزاداران حسین جناب امام موسیٰ کاظم علیہ السلام کی مظلومیت منفرد اس عنوان سے ہے کہ شہادت ہر امام نے پائی ہے لیکن زندان میں کوئی امام اس دنیا سے نہیں گیا ہتھکڑی لگی ہے امام زین العابدین کے ہاتھوں میں پیر میں بیڑیاں لگی ہیں لیکن امام زین العابدین کے امامت کے آغاز میں یہ ہوا ہے لیکن امام موسیٰ کاظم علیہ السلام کی شہادت واقع ہوئی ہے کہ جب زنجیر اور ہتھکڑی لگی ہوئی تھی ان کے ہاتھ اور پیر میں عزاداران حسین جب امام کے لاشے کو غلام سب لے آتے ہیں سند بن شاہق ملعون کے، اور پل بغداد پر رکھ دیا جاتا ہے یہ بتانے کے لیے کہ وہ رافضی اور شیعہ جو ان کو سمجھتے تھے کہ یہ کبھی مرنے والے نہیں ہیں، وہ لوگ آ کے دیکھ لیں اپنے امام کی لاش کو کہ وہ زندہ نہ رہے، اس طرح سے اس جسم کی تشہیر ہوتی ہے. لیکن ہارون کا ایک چچا تھا، اسی پل کے قریب رہتا تھا، اس نے جب شور اور شرابہ سنا ہے، جب پوچھا ہے کہ کیا ہے، جب بتایا گیا کہ موسیٰ ابن جعفر کا انتقال ہو گیا ہے اور لاش جو ہے لا کے پل بغداد پر رکھی گئی ہے، وہ اپنے غلاموں کو حکم دیتا ہے کہ امام کے لاشے کو اس کے گھر لایا جائے. احترام سے غسل دیا گیا اور احتراماً جا کے قریش کے قبرستان میں امام کو دفن کیا گیا ہے. مولا سے صرف اتنا کہیں گے، امام رضا علیہ السلام کی خدمت میں پرسا کے لیے صرف اتنا کہیں گے کہ یقیناً مولا کی لاش کو پل بغداد پر رکھنا امام کی لاش کی توہین تھی، لیکن پھر بھی دشمن کے ایک چچا تھا جس کے دل میں یہ احساس ہوا کہ آل رسول کی یہ لاش اس طرح سے اس کی بے حرمتی نہیں ہو سکتی ہے. وہ غلاموں کو حکم دیتا ہے اور جنازہ احترام کے ساتھ اٹھانے کے بعد دفن کر دیا جاتا ہے. لیکن ہائے وہ ابا عبداللہ الحسین، ان کا لاشا پھر زمین کربلا میں صرف پڑا نہیں رہا، بلکہ عمر بن سعد ملعون حکم دیتا ہے کہ گھوڑے سوار آئے اور یہ گھوڑے اس طرح سے چلے ہیں کہ حسین کے سینے کی ہڈیاں پشت کی ہڈیوں سے جا کے مل جاتی ہے. وہاں ایک بہن دیکھ رہی تھی منظر کو، ہاتھ کو بلند کر کے کہتی ہے نانا آسمان کے ملائکہ آپ پر صلوات پڑھتے ہیں، زمین کربلا میں آ کے دیکھے آپ کے نواسے کے لاش کو کس طرح سے پامال کیا گیا. لعنة الله على القوم الظالمين. ما تم حسين.